All right, awesome. Thank you all for joining us today. As you can see, our topic for the session is caring and engaging from afar, clinical command centers and care at home. My name is Katie Smith-Green. I lead our content marketing here at Current Health, and I'm going to do a quick introduction of our presenters for today. Joining us live, there we go, thank you. We have Lieutenant Colonel Dan York, who is our Director of Clinical Command Center and Solution Design. Here at Current, Dan oversees our Clinical Command Center and consults with clients on solution design. He is a retired Army Lieutenant Colonel, and prior to joining Current Health, he served as the Deputy Director of Operations at the Defense Health Agency's Virtual Medical Center. Dan has over 6 years of telehealth and remote patient monitoring program management experience, and Dan joins us today from Washington, D.C., where he's been meeting with some senators on the Hill. Thank you for carving out the time to be here today, Dan. Our next presenter is Kim Wasmuth, who serves as our telehealth lead for the Clinical Command Center. She is an RN with experience in both remote care and remote patient monitoring program design and development. Kim specializes in chronic disease monitoring and serves as a subject matter expert for program development processes. Kim joins us today from San Antonio. And Michael Ergel is a clinical operations manager with our implementation team, where he guides and manages the setup of new care at home programs across the country. Prior to joining Current Health, he worked for GE Healthcare, where he was a specialist in monitoring solutions and alarm analytics. Michael is also a registered nurse with experience in ICU, transplant, and emergency care. Michael joins us today from Washington, where he is also with Dan visiting with some senators. If you are new around here, just a quick word about Current Health. Here's a look at what we do. We are really honored to support care at home programs across the US and the UK, ranging from high acuity virtual ward and hospital at home programs to those chronic condition management programs. We're really proud of our focus on creating value through improved outcomes and operational efficiency, as well as our patient-centric experience. A quick look at how we support these programs in our platform, as we really provide that clear window into patients' conditions in the home and help our clients to build and scale these care at home programs. So our platform combines proprietary monitoring, our own proprietary monitoring device, with additional connected devices and patient reported data. We then display that insight into the patient status in a user-friendly dashboard, which includes tools for patient engagement, virtual and in-home services. And it really is our aim to help healthcare organizations fill any gaps that they have for end-to-end healthcare at home services, which is part of what we'll be just focusing on today in our discussion about clinical command centers. As part of Best Buy Health, we're really excited to see some of those enhanced capabilities for operationalizing and scaling care at home. A quick look at our discussion for today. We are going to start by unpacking what clinical command centers are and how they really support care at home programs. As I mentioned, Dan and Kim both work to build our own clinical command center, so they're going to share some lessons learned about that experience. And then Kim is going to walk us through kind of some things to keep in mind if your organization is looking to build an internal command center. It really is our hope that our clients' programs grow to the place where it makes sense for them to build out this own central function. So she's going to provide some guidance and lessons learned on that undertaking. And then we'll welcome a special guest to share some patient stories with us about the kinds of interactions our command center nurses are able to have with patients and the impact that that makes on their health. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Dan to kick us off.
All right, great. Thank you for the introduction, Katie. That's awesome. So I'm Dan York. I'm the director of the Clinical Command Center. So thank you all for attending today. Really appreciate your time. So really, what is a clinical command center or a command center in general? I say it that way because there's a lot of different terms out there, and I'll go into that in a second, but really, a command center is what you make it or what your organization needs. I also want to kind of mention here at the beginning that I am going to ask Kim and Michael to jump in and add some dialogue or, you know, help me out with anything I forget. I like webinars where there's more of an interactive discussion versus just one person presenting to you. I hope you are okay with that forum, but that's what we'll probably do a little bit today. So what is a clinical command center? So it really is a clinical organization or a body of people or a group of people that can provide, manage, and coordinate care virtually. Your next slide, Kim. And so there's a lot of different names for command centers. You have virtual command center, medical command center, clinical command center, operational command center. And honestly, in a lot of places and in my experience over the last 6 years, some of these are often synonymous with one another. It's just what your organization chose to call it on that day, or who the leader was, or who made that decision to call it something. We made the decision to call ours the Clinical Command Center. We felt like it really embodied what we were trying to do. We're not necessarily delivering care, but we're providing support services to our clients and to their patients. The virtual command center, I've heard that used a couple of different ways. When I was in the Defense Health Agency, we had the virtual medical center, and we had our virtual command center. We had nurses providing monitoring support. Medical command centers, I've heard that used where you have more along the lines of your skilled or your licensed, like APPs or MDs, who are delivering medical care. Operational command centers, depending on what context you're discussing it in. If you're in the military, an operational command center could be your, focus over the entire battle area. Whereas, of course, we're talking about healthcare. It still is applicable even on the government or on the military side of things. So my point here is there's a lot of different ways you can name it, but really what it is again, the organization, or it's a group of people or an organizational body that allows you to do what it is you need to do with those people. Whether that be, remote monitoring where you have your command center geographically dispersed like we do, we have our nurses working from home, or you have them all in one location. It could be, a telemetry command center. A lot of hospitals have, their, telemetry monitoring units, or their, command centers where they're doing telemetry monitoring internal to their facility. So there's just a lot of different names and a lot of different ways you can do it. I mention all of this because what we're going to be really focusing on after this is our command center, the clinical command center, and the way that we stood it up. I want to also mention that there is no right or wrong way to do this. This is a way, not the only way of doing it. So we're hoping that the experiences that we've had, the lessons learned, will be valuable to you and to your organization as you go forward, if you're going to go down this road and look at doing something along these lines. Next slide. Okay. So really a core question that you have to ask yourself when you're building a care at home program. And I want to highlight also that we're talking about care at home programs now. I know I kind of transitioned away from talking about overarching clinical command centers or command centers. And now I'm going to focus on what we do, which is care at home programs and delivering support to those types of programs through our command center. So you have to ask yourself, who monitors these patients? That's a key component of standing up a command center and standing up your program. We'll go to the next slide, Kim. So when you ask yourself this, you have to ask, is this gonna be an additional responsibility for your existing staff? Meaning that you're gonna try and kind of take it out of hide somewhere and figure out who's gonna do this as an additional duty or as an additional assignment. You're gonna task somebody with this. You're gonna use your PRN float pool, whatever the case may be. That's one way of building this type of a capability. Or you have to look at, is this gonna be a primary responsibility for a dedicated team where either you, take them from internal to your organization, or you go out and hire a group of people or to do this monitoring for you. The monitoring can include, remote patient monitoring. It could be like check-ins with patients. There's a lot of different ways of doing the monitoring, but it's still important to understand how are you going to do it? Who is going to do it? Because we've had some experiences where organizations really didn't think that through. And so I'm going to actually ask Michael to, because he's on our implementation side, kind of talk a little bit about his experiences here and what he's seen in this space.
Yeah, Dan, you bring up two really great questions here. How are you going to do it and who's going to do it? Because monitoring at home can be a completely new ecosystem for a healthcare system or for a group who wants to stand up a program that monitors patients virtually or remotely, this aspect of the operations tends to be overlooked. So we tend, what we've seen in the past is customers are hyper-focused on standing up a program, identifying that use case, and then how to leverage the technologies. But then standing up a clinical command center is almost like an afterthought. And that could have some negative downstream effects, especially, you know, in some of our experiences, some customers have had to pull different staff members from existing roles. So if you're taking in that core role that a staff member has and compounding that with additional monitoring responsibilities, you're going to burn out your staff very easily. And some things could get really missed here when we're talking about from a quality perspective of really defining what that monitoring role is.
Yeah, thank you, Michael. I really appreciate you chiming in on that one. And you also have to think about, you know, when you talk about second and third order effects, if you're going to pull from another unit or you're going to pull from existing staff, what impact does that have on that unit? What impact does that have on another service you're providing to the organization? However, the flip side to that is if you're standing up a program and you just don't have the capital or the ability to go out and hire more staff or new staff, maybe that's your only choice. But understand that if you are going to go out and create this capability on your own, it can be expensive. You know, hiring nurses is not exactly easy in this environment right now. However, what's really cool about this is because your nurses can monitor from literally anywhere, there's some licensing and other stuff that you have to consider there. You can broaden your aperture as far as where you're recruiting from. So just kind of put that out there. And I think Kim's going to talk a little bit about that later and our experience with recruitment. Because our nurses all work from home, they all live in nurse licensed compact states. So we were able to really recruit from 36 different states around the country, which was pretty a really great experience for us. Next slide. So, you know, how do clinical command centers support care at home? There's a number of different ways, but these are just a couple of them that we wanted to highlight, especially with the care at home programs. You know, you can reduce your time to go live when you have a dedicated team or when you have a team of people to help with the monitoring support. You know, if you have that dedicated team, they can help you with your user acceptance testing. They can help you identify workflows, and they're the ones that are going to be using it every day. They're going to be doing it every day. And so what better group of people to help you go live and get to the point of being successful with your program? Help with enrollment and scaling. This is huge. Again, a lot of times organizations might not consider the enrollment aspect or the scaling aspect of building a care at home program, whether that be hospital at home, chronic disease management, you name it. You know, you have to get clinician buy-in. You have to get your licensed providers to buy into the idea of what you're doing, whatever the program is. And your clinical command centers, your command centers can help with the marketing, help with recruitment of physicians, having those clinical conversations, explaining to the physicians why this is so important and the benefits of what you're doing. And then the other thing is, you know, that staff can help you scale your program. Again, it goes back to getting people involved, helping people in the organization understand the value of what it is you're doing, and having people in the command center who are dedicated, who understand what it is you're doing, who can speak the language, you know, they can go out and help you scale your program. And the last thing I'll point out, which I'm really excited about our metrics on this one, is patient adherence and engagement. A lot of times, you know, in the past, I've seen some, you know, monitoring devices that I've used in other jobs outside of Current Health, where the device goes out to the patient, right? But then there's no follow-up, there's no engagement. And so the patient gets it, and then within a day or two, they don't use it anymore. So what's the point of enrolling them into a program, spending the money on it, and doing all that thing if you don't have adherence from the patients? For us, the patients that we monitor, we have greater than a 90% adherence with the wearable devices. We have a greater than 85% adherence with taking their blood pressures on time. So we've been very successful at promoting adherence, and your command center can help you do that. They can engage the patients, especially when you're having those patients, you're having problems with getting them adherent to the technology that you're using, whatever that technology is, whether it's Current Health or another, it's important. Next slide. So this is just one example of what our clinical command center does. Again, this is just a way, not the only way. But some of our responsibilities for the nurses that work for me is triaging alarms. Through our technology, we can establish alarms based off of different protocols and based on protocols and implementation with our clients that use our systems. We establish that up front, and then our nurses respond to those alarms and engage patients as necessary. We watch trends. We look for trends in the patient's health. We proactively engage when we think it's necessary. We personally use Schmidt-Thompson protocols to triage patients either when we identify something that's wrong or the patient doesn't feel well or is having an issue. They can request engagement from us, and then we can triage them using Schmidt-Thompson protocols. We have the ability to initiate emergency services. And I can't stress this one enough. Like, a lot of people don't consider this when they're building their program is, what are you going to do if the patient is, you know, decompensating and they can't get themselves to the ER? They don't have a family member to take them. You know, have you thought through what your emergency action plan is? Have you thought through, you know, making sure you have that patient's address up front? Because if you don't and you have an emergency, how do you know where to send the EMS providers, right? So you got to think through those things up front and make sure you have a plan in place to address what we call in the military a PACE plan, your primary, alternate, contingency, and emergency plans. Sorry, I'm bringing the military out in me a little bit there. But I brought that here to Current Health. And so we have a PACE plan for every organization that we support. We coordinate in-home services. And then finally, intervene and escalate care. So we don't employ APPs or advanced practice providers or, you know, medical doctors or DOs internally to our clinical command center. However, that is a model that you can use. There are some models that use physicians to monitor. I don't think they stick around very long because that's extremely expensive. But then there's other organizations that use, you know, MAs or other non-clinical staff. Regardless, for us, we rely on our clients, on the health systems we support, to leverage their providers if we need to escalate care that's not like a true emergency. It doesn't need EMS, but it does need some type of physician intervention or interaction with the patient. And that's how we handle that component. Next slide. This is just an example of our workflow, and this is a very bare bones example. It's a lot more complicated than this, but essentially when a patient is enrolled or admitted, we participate in the new patient huddles. We participate in morning reports, and we really want to be a part of that care team from when the patient gets activated to, you know, patient monitoring and engagement. We do alarm triage, and then we interact with the care team to coordinate care and to adjust alarms, adjust protocols, and make adjustments that are in the best interest of that patient, so that we're not overburdening them, or so that our nurses don't have alarm fatigue. Next slide. So that was my portion. I'm gonna have to jump off because as Kitty said, I am in DC and I have to go to another meeting, but I'm gonna hand it off here to Michael and Kim and let them finish it out. So again, thank you all for your time, and Michael, I'll turn it over to you.
All right, thanks, Dan. I'll see you in a little bit. So what we're showing in this visual here are two distinguished examples of how clinical command center monitoring works. So first of all, it's really important to be able to define the need or define the problem statement, understanding the saliency of delivering that need, and then also being able to define within the spectrum of tactility how that level of involvement should be defined. And also furthermore to understanding the risks that are involved. So the way that a hospital at home support is provided can differ from a CHF program or a chronic disease management program support. So if you're thinking hospital at home, these patients are in the acute stages of recovery from any sort of exacerbation of a condition. So that requires a little bit higher touch monitoring. So where you're monitoring 24/7, 365, you're looking at trends from continuous monitoring of their vital signs and the level of encounters between the care team or the provider team with the patient is at a higher touch level compared to your condition management or your chronic condition management support, where you have patients that may be enrolled in your program for months or even up to a year, maybe even longer, where you're really looking at trends, not, you know, from hours or days, but really more so on weeks and months. Granted, each of these types of target populations do carry a level of risk. You know, your condition management patient might have an acute exacerbation of COPD, et cetera, that would require them an escalation of a higher level of care. But really, it's being able to understand the program's needs in terms of how often to monitor and how often to interact with these types of patients. So the next slide that we are going to show you is the amount of impact that standing up our clinical command center has had with our customers. We've seen 160% increase in the average daily census in one of our customers. Also too, we've seen a marked increase in the average daily admissions after that clinical command center support was implemented. And then the clinical command center, in tandem with the customer organization, has been able to provide up to 55,000 hours of care in their home versus in a brick and mortar hospital. So really having that clinical command center as an integral part of your care team can really make virtual care or monitoring at home possible for these patients. Some lessons learned that the clinical command center has had, it's really important, kind of like what Dan had mentioned, including them in morning rounds. So for patient-specific things or events that may have happened overnight, understanding how to adjust those alarms specifically to really accommodate for those patient conditions on a unique level, understanding if there's any sort of changes or modifications to a clinical pathway for that particular patient. Furthermore, too, these morning rounds help to just decrease the amount of gaps in communication between the vendor of the clinical command center representing as a vendor partner and then the customer organization or the healthcare system. Another thing too to consider is make sure you do consider overlaps between the shifts in clinical command center staff. So kind of having that round the clock support, making sure that there is no latency in who is monitoring these patients. And then another thing too that was really pivotal for the clinical command center is really providing them with access to read-only for the customer's EHR electronic health record, just so they can understand the full experience of that patient right down from the progress notes that the provider team is composing in their EHR. And so I want to hand it off next to Kim to talk about building a clinical command center.
Thank you, Michael. First, I got to apologize. I had to switch up a little bit on my technology, so I'm going to be looking down a little bit more than I planned to. So when deciding whether to build or outsource your clinical command center, it's important to consider the knowledge and experience of your team in the space, your financial resources, your staffing resources, and most significantly, time. A team with the knowledge and experience that's necessary to build a command center is key to cost efficiency and timeliness. However, even if you have an experienced team and are able to get a command center up and running smoothly, it still requires a $1 to $2 million capital investment to stand one up. This figure includes the cost for compensation, technology, and staff licensing and training, among other requirements for a successful CCC. Beyond the financial investment, you must also consider your staffing investment. Start with the following questions. Do you hire or pull staff from other units or programs to staff your CCC? Then do you dedicate that staff to your CCC, or do you add the CCC to your rotations? If you pull staff from another unit or program, as Dan mentioned, you need to really consider the impact it has on the organization as a whole, and can you even afford to do that? I consider time the most important consideration. The time dedicated to developing a successful CCC will cost you resources without generating income for the first 1 to 2 years. Consider if your organization is prepared to support your CCC during the development and slow growth period. At this point, I'd like to invite Michael to share some of his thoughts based on his experience helping clients develop and implement their own CCCs.
Thanks, Kim. So a few key important points that I kind of want to call out here is understanding program sustainability. So, you know, maybe you start first with a hospital at home program, but should your system want to scale to potentially other use cases, establishing those different protocols, even within that hospital at home program, but even furthermore, if you're expanding your depth or breadth into chronic condition management, how are you incrementally trying to scale and making sure that you have a team that is adaptable and resilient to those different types of needs from those target populations? Another thing too is organizational strength or resilience. So dealing with attrition, how do you make sure that you find the right fit to hire for your group? And, you know, how do you empower them, culturally speaking, to really be a strong monitoring role and empowering them not only as clinicians, but also, you know, not in the traditional setting, yes, with bedside manner, but, you know, there's this term that called website manner that Kim has kind of shared with me, and it's kind of stuck in my head here, but really providing care and being able to translate that in the virtual space.
Thank you, Michael. Because it costs the same in time and resources to monitor one patient as it does to monitor 30, many organizations choose to outsource their CCC during the development period. An experienced CCC service provider will save you time and resources because you don't have to reinvent the wheel. They should provide you with guidance on best practices, modifiable protocols, workflows, and processes, and experienced staff to monitor your patients. Though outsourcing becomes less cost-effective after a program reaches a certain census, which differs from program to program, it relieves your organization of the burden of staffing while still allowing you to retain full oversight over all of your patients. This benefit grows with the size and scope of the program. For example, an organization which has hospital-at-home programs at multiple locations across multiple states requires a decision to either build and staff multiple CCCs or build one CCC that serves all locations. The latter requires licensing of all licensed clinical staff in every state in which they will practice. Outsourcing to a CCC service has the added benefit of delegating the onus of licensing management and costs to your CCC vendor. If your organization chooses to build an in-house command center, your structure will depend on your use case, specifically your program model, patient population, program goals and scope, and your vision for the program's future. Your first step will be choosing your model. There are many existing program models available, including hospital at home, post-acute or transitional care, chronic disease monitoring, and clinical trial monitoring. When choosing your program model, it's important to thoroughly research the requirements of that model and consider if your organization has the capability to support them. Each model has requirements that will inform your program structure and staffing models because it will define your billing and reimbursement strategy and your patient services. After you've chosen your model, identifying the patient population, goals and scope of the program, and vision for its future will help to determine the structure based on the staffing and resource requirements for the program. Some things to consider while defining your CCC structure are the benefits and challenges of a central location versus remote working. We have the unique opportunity in virtual health to provide care from afar. So consider if the cost to provide space in a central location is worth the perceived benefit of on-site working. Though a bare bones clinical command center with limited scope can run efficiently and successfully with no more than a director and a team of virtual health nurses, in order to do so, your program must include processes and procedures which incorporate protocols that allow the nurses to practice at the top of their scope, escalation pathways that identify a provider or team of providers available for escalation at all times patients are monitored, a designation of responsibilities beyond the traditional nursing role to your nursing staff. If the scope of services provided by your clinical command center go beyond nursing, it's important to consider the scope of practice of your staff and their role within your CCC. Some additional roles you may want to consider include other licensed clinicians, such as social workers or speech therapists, non-licensed staff, including administrative and clinical support staff, or providers such as PharmDs, physicians, and advanced practice providers. Once you've determined the roles your clinical command center staff will fill, your next step is creating a staffing model which provides coverage during your program service hours. Multiple factors impact staffing. Program-based factors to consider include business hours, services provided, staff PTO, on-call coverage, leave coverage, and efficiency of processes and procedures and administrative requirements. Role-based factors to consider include patient engagements and the scope of those engagements, time to execute tasks, and the efficiency of your technology and workflows. Unfortunately, very little research has been conducted on nurse-patient ratios in virtual health and remote patient monitoring. However, it's been our experience here at RCCC that around-the-clock monitoring support requires a minimum of 6 FTE nurses or 7 if you don't have a float pool or other resource to cover leave and absenteeism. If you're staffing a daytime only monitoring program, your staffing needs will be dependent on census and your staff to nurse patient or your staff to patient ratios. In our workflows, we found that one nurse can support up to 30 hospital at home patients and up to 150 chronic disease patients. The most influential determining factor in staff to patient ratios is patient engagements. The more extensive the patient engagements, the fewer patients a staff member can support. Therefore, your workflows will greatly impact the number of patients your staff can safely and effectively care for. Recruitment for CCC positions looks a little different than for traditional clinical positions. The best candidates for a position within a clinical command center are forward-thinking professionals who have a passion for technology and want to be a part of charting the future of medicine. As a new modality of care, virtual health is a specialty that requires skills that are not yet taught in most clinical schools. Additionally, the rate of change in this space requires more than just flexibility. It really requires an enthusiasm for change and innovation that will help your staff embrace the frequent fluctuations in both technology and their workflows. The constant change and development in this environment means CCC staff must be versatile, resilient, and adaptable to achieve success in this space. Look for candidates who think outside the box, enjoy collaboration, and have strong clinical decision-making skills. That is the candidate you want to add to your CCC staff. Though many of these qualities are buzzwords that most people include on their resumes, find ways to screen for them through an imaginative interview process. For example, virtual interviews are a prime opportunity to test that website manner Michael was just talking about and tech skills. A multiple interview process in which the candidate interviews with multiple people with different personalities is a great way to screen for people skills, professionalism, and adaptability. Finally, a working interview during which the candidate walks you through a task or teaches you something will help gauge their ability to teach virtually. Though finding enough candidates who meet these qualifications to staff your CCC may sound difficult, you're not constrained by the limiting factors of a traditional clinical candidate pool. For example, the physical requirements of a virtual health RN position differ significantly than for those for a bedside RN position. A virtual health RN will not be required to provide any physical care to the patient, so your candidate pool can include RNs who are unable or unwilling to work at the bedside. This includes nurses who are suffering from burnout or a physical condition that limits their ability to provide physical care. Additionally, you can greatly increase your candidate pool by choosing a remote work environment. This allows your staff to work from anywhere in the country, as long as they are able to be licensed within the state or states in which they practice. The benefits of remote work also include reduced overhead and risk for impact across your workforce by natural disasters. Plus, people love working from home, and in our experience, they're more productive. The secret is to hire the right people. Our philosophy for hiring here in Current Health CCC is to look for candidates with qualities that we can nurture and develop into leaders who will someday replace us. Though traditional hiring practices focuses on the candidate's experience and skills as they apply to the job position, we believe in hiring the person for their fit to the team and developing those skills through training and experience. This practice has proven to be instrumental in our success. Our nurses went from novice to subject matter experts in 3 months. Because remote work and virtual care is new to the nursing world, we had to rethink traditional onboarding processes and rewrite the training playbook. The key success factors in our training program are focus, format, and function. We keep our training focused on the skills and knowledge necessary to perform the nursing role. We weed out the extraneous information, then create opportunities for professional growth after our new hires have mastered the basics. The format we use for each training session is chosen for its ability to communicate the information and to allow the nurses to practice using the technology. It provides both informational and functional learning, killing the proverbial two birds with one stone. Choosing our staff based on qualities and developing their skills has paid off tenfold. With a little investment in team building, trust, and knowledge, we have built a group of rockstar telehealth nurses who help us to define our processes, procedures, and product. Their input has allowed Current Health the unique ability to tap into the end user experience, helping to increase the success of our company as a whole. As we prepare to extend our CCC, we are excited to test this philosophy beyond our US borders with our future UK team. We look forward to the new talent, ideas, and experience they will bring with them. Now, I'd like to give Michael an opportunity to talk about the Care at Home ecosystem and the opportunities to use command centers to facilitate and bridge gaps in care.
Thanks, Kim. So, unleashing the potential of a command center. So Kim and Dan have talked about operational strengths of monitoring and triage and proactive patient engagement. But as we transition into a future state where we are seeing more and more patients, exponentially speaking, being monitored at home, we really see the command center being a conduit of these ancillary services. So not only the monitoring aspects of it, and the proactive patient engagement, but deploying in-home services that patients may need, whether that's drawing labs, any sort of mobile radiology services, providing remote and in-home tech support of the technologies that are deployed to monitor a patient, as well as coordinating transportation, not only for needs that could be for a MRI that's a routine or a schedule one, but also coordinating with the community for EMS services. Those kinds of things can also be greatly heightened. So really, where we see the command center being built is outside of just the depth of its clinical realm, where it's deeply rooted, but also furthermore into really integrating as part of the entire ecosystem. So next, I want to hand it out over to Haley Richardson, who is a telehealth nurse and a representative of our clinical command center.
Thanks, Michael. Great information so far, everyone. My name is Haley, like Michael said. Good afternoon, good evening, everyone. I'm one of the registered nurses in the Clinical Command Center, and I'm happy to be here today to share just two of the many patient stories that highlight the impact and effectiveness of remote patient monitoring. During rounds, our team noticed a patient's heart rate was sustaining in the hundreds, and immediately engaged the patient when she submitted a low blood pressure of 75 over 47. The patient admitted to having symptomatic hypotension. Despite feeling dizzy, shaky, and weak, she was attempting to complete a long list of house chores before resting. The patient refused emergency care and said she was planning on calling her sister to take her to the emergency room after she finished all her housework hours later. The clinical command center nurse was able to educate the patient, instructed her to take a rest, drink some water, prop up her feet, and rest while she called the on-site nursing team. After the on-site nursing team was paged, the patient told the on-site nurse not to bother with further interventions because after resting, she felt much better. Later, the CCC nurse re-engaged the patient to check in, and she was significantly improved. Her blood pressure was up to 121 over 85, and her heart rate was back down to her baseline of the 90s. Because the CCC intervened and educated the patient at the onset of symptoms, potentially bad outcomes such as a fall, head strike, or loss of consciousness were avoided. The patient stated she was grateful for the timely phone call from the CCC nurse, and typically she would just push through her symptoms, so she was happy for the nudge to take a rest. The second patient's story is near to my heart as I was the monitoring nurse in this situation. The patient was a lovely 96-year-old female with chronic congestive heart failure. She lived alone. I noticed that her respiratory status was declining. Her oxygen was trending down, her heart rate was trending up, and this was steady for over an hour. Unfortunately, I was unable to reach the patient after multiple attempts of phone and video, so I paged the on-site nursing team. The site didn't currently have the resources to send someone to go to the patient's home, and so after watching the vitals for a little bit longer and seeing that they were continuing to worsen, I engaged EMS so that someone could physically check on the patient. When EMS arrived, the patient was not feeling well, and they discovered that she had inadvertently taken off her oxygen. After assessing her and assisting her in getting her oxygen back on, the EMS crew determined that she didn't need to be taken to the emergency department for two reasons. First, she refused to go. And second, her vital signs were stabilizing quite nicely. Her vitals are back to baseline, and the clinical command center was continuing to monitor her. Remote patient monitoring enabled this patient to get the support she needed prior to any deleterious effects that would require hospitalization. And this patient was very grateful for that. If the patient wasn't being monitored by the clinical command center nurses, she may have continued to worsen and had a much different clinical outcome. These examples just scratch the surface of positive patient outcomes we've seen in the clinical command center. Thank you so much for allowing me to share these stories on behalf of our nursing team. And I'll hand it over to Katie now.
Thank you so much, Haley. I know there are so many wonderful examples of your team interacting with patients and honestly preventing some very serious escalations. Thank you for joining us today. We do have a few questions in the chat. We're going to try to get to real quickly. We have one from Karen here asking about clinical buy-in, currently a great issue for their program in Greater Manchester, England. Any golden nuggets you're able to share that are some quick wins? Michael or Kim, you want to take a stab at some quick and dirty tips here on clinical buy-in, a massive topic?
Yeah, Karen, definitely a great question. I would love to. You know, if you're trying to understand it, like being able to understand the risk sharing that's related to monitoring of these patients in your health system, but also a golden nugget is really how you frame this approach to those clinicians. What's really important is the clinical command center can be that overarching monitoring source that continues to keep patients engaged. Therefore, it kind of, you know, works in offsetting any additional work of staff that have added on responsibilities compounded to what their core work is already at.
Thanks, Michael. That's a really great point. Another thing that, well, one of the main resistance factors that I've seen throughout my time here working with our clients, but also prior to this, I built the chronic disease remote patient monitoring programs for a big hospital or a big medical system. And one of the main resistance points is, first of all, them retaining control and oversight over their patients, the clinicians not necessarily trusting the new modality of care, and also not already having a workflow and process that will allow them to easily bring that into their current clinical processes. So one of the things that I really like to share and discuss is how easily modifiable any sort of virtual health is, and how it really does just extend their reach. It doesn't take control from their from them over their patients. So really, it just adds another set of eyes, it gives them a lot more data. And that's really usually the turning point is when they realize that with very, very little extra work, they get all of this extra information that we just aren't used to having.
That's a great point, Kim. I know we've seen in several clients the importance of really closing that loop with the referring provider or the consultant, and making sure that they know what happened to that patient that they did refer to the Care at Home program. So patient goes into a virtual ward, following up with that provider and making sure that they know, here's what happens, you know, with that patient, and you know, she's able to stay home now, has, you know, not been back to the emergency department, et cetera. But that, I'm so glad that you asked about this one, Karen, because clinician buy-in is so important to building and really scaling these programs. We are going to be hosting a webinar in the near future, really talking about what does it mean to market your program, right? What does it mean to build that engagement with those crucial audiences that you can't do it without, right? You can't do it without the right provider sending patients to the care model. And ultimately they have to trust it to do that, as Kim has pointed out. So great one, stay tuned. We are gonna have some more guidance on that very important topic. Another real quick question we got here from Michael: are alarms adjusted individually for patients or systematically across patients? The question about the current health platform there, Michael, what is your, what's your guidance on that one?
Yeah, thanks, Katie. So if I can kind of just start with step one. So, you know, when we do work with customers from an implementation standpoint, there are default thresholds that we'll incorporate. And then once a program has stood up, then those alarms can be adjusted on an individual patient basis.
Yeah, great. We love that high configurability. A couple of other questions about just getting the recording and the slides. We will be sending that out. Progressing to our last slide there, Kim, thank you. We will be sending that out to all of you who are with us today, as well as anybody who might have registered and couldn't join us live. Watch for the recording and a copy of the slides in your inbox next week. And Donald, I see a question from you. We are gonna follow up with you about that one after the event. Thank you so much for that question as well. Sorry, that is not gonna be August 31st. We are gonna have to move that, but it is coming, so stay tuned. And thank you all. Please take the survey that you will get on your screen as you leave the session. And we hope to see you next time. Bye.